Well, good morning. I sound a little warm. It's good to be back. I was very much enjoying my time off. I appreciate the church allowing me to take that time off. Sometimes we run ourselves ragged and we need some time to refresh ourselves. I was able to read about 4 books in my time off and go to the coast and just get a little refreshed in the Lord. And so I appreciate Pastor Mike and Pastor Chris filling in for me when I was gone, but it is good to be back. It's nice to go to other churches, it's nice to visit different places, but it's always good to be home to the home church and see the people that you love and know that love you. Well, I think you love me at least. Yeah, that's good. It's good to be back here. Hey, I want to keep you informed. This week, as you know, there's an election coming up. I'm sure everybody here is aware of that. Well, we are having an election here on this campus. Our campus is a polling place for the city, and so we will have lots of people coming and going on our campus on Tuesday morning. So be praying for the people that come across our campus. I'm going to be on the campus a little bit during the day as well to try and visit with some people perhaps in the afternoon and welcome them to our church. But be praying for our election as well. If you're like me, you're probably ready for it to be over with and to move on and maybe change the climate of conversation in our nation. But be praying for our next president, whether it's the person you vote for or the person it's that you don't vote for. Be praying that God's will would be done in our nation and that God would just lead the next president of our nation. And so we want to be praying for that together. Also, this evening, we have a pastor in our denomination who, if you recall, several months ago was in a pretty serious car accident. And his name is Benjamin Bermude, and his wife had a baby, and she was in neck traction the whole time that she was pregnant, had a baby, and they're really struggling right now with some finances and some things going on in their life. And so this evening, we're going to try and take up a little bit of a collection for them as a church to just encourage them, let them know that there's other churches that are thinking about them and praying for them. In fact, there are some of our people from our church this morning that are up at that church visiting with them to try and encourage them as well. So let's be praying for that couple as well. This morning, we're going to be in Luke chapter 22. I want to mention, just before we get into the scripture also, I appreciate all the gifts and all the kind words and all the text messages that were sent and phone calls that were made over the last month. And the month of October, Pastor Appreciation Month, and our family felt definitely appreciated. Our kids felt appreciated with some of the goodies that were sent over for them. I think I gained about 10 pounds with all the snacks that people have provided for me over the month. But we love this church and appreciate the kindness that people have shown towards us and appreciate the people taking us out to meals and doing all kinds of nice stuff for us. It really is a blessing to be a part of a church that that loves you. And so I am very grateful for that. My wife is grateful. My kids are grateful. And appreciate the kindness that you've shown to our family. Let's pray together this morning. Heavenly Father, I thank you for our time that we have together this morning. I thank you for the opportunity that we have to be just worshiping you in this house and, Lord, seeking your will for our lives and trying to understand your plan for our lives in this church, God, through the word that you have given us. I pray, God, this morning as we go through our time together and we partake of the Lord's Supper together, that you would Lord, edify this time together, that you would help us to just have a deeper sense of who you are, a deeper sense of what you desire from us in our lives. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. And Chris, can I have you go get the rest of these? I've got to bring them in this morning. One of the things that we're going to be doing this morning is one of the longest traditions in the history of the church. That is the act of remembering the Lord's Supper. Not something we do here in the Sunday mornings very often at Harmony. We typically do it on Wednesday night or Sunday night as a congregation. But as many of you know, we've been going through Dinner with Jesus series over the last about 8 weeks, the last 2 months. And there is no dinner scene that is more important than this dinner scene. So, if I'm going to teach on this dinner scene, it seems appropriate that we should probably take the Lord's Supper together this morning. And for nearly 2,000 years in the history of the church, think about this. The Lord's Supper has been taken in different forms, in different places, and in different corners of the globe for such a long time. And every denomination and every practice has applied it to their faith in some measure or another. Some call it communion. Maybe you've heard it said that way. Some call it the Lord's table, the Lord's Supper. If you're from a Catholic background, you probably are familiar with the term Eucharist. And all Eucharist means, by the way, is just Eucharistia in the Greek, which means to give thanks, where the Bible says when Jesus took the bread, he broke it and he gave thanks. He Eucharistia, he gave thanks. And so I'm not really concerned about what we call it. I'm more concerned about its significance for our lives and what God wants to remind us through this act. Really, if you think about it, it's a little strange, you know? I mean, think about it. You're going to get a little cup with a little juice in it, and you're going to swig that, and then you're going to get a little wafer, and you're going to chow that down, and we're going to say, hey, remember Jesus in doing that. Kind of an odd tradition if you were an outsider looking in, really. Think of it in this term. Suppose, you know, just if we were to go down to after church, I say, hey, let's everybody go to Costco, right? And we're going to get a Costco hot dog. And we're going to get a Costco drink, a soda. And as we all get ready to eat our hot dog and drink, I say, wait, stop. Now, I lift up my hot dog and say, now, as you eat this hot dog, do this in remembrance of Pastor Chad. You'd say, that's just bizarre. Isn't that weird? And then I say, and, you know, take the cup and say, now, as you drink your Coca-Cola, do this in remembrance of Pastor Chad. It's just food and drink. And then, even more bizarre, every time you go to Costco, you say to your kids, as they're eating a hot dog and drinking this soda, hey, you know, let's eat our hot dog and drink the soda, and let's think about Pastor Chad when we do that. Right? And then you tell your descendants that, and so 2,000 years from now, you know, every time people go to Costco and have a hot dog and have a drink, they think, oh yeah, let's remember Pastor Chad. Don't you think it's a little weird? That would be weird. And yet that is what we do when we are taking the Lord's Supper. He commands us to remember him when we take these elements that we are going to partake of. It's just food and drink, but it's not just food and drink. There's a significance of spiritual symbolism and significance behind that is fundamental to your belief system as a Christian. This is why every denomination practices the Lord's Supper. This is why even around the globe this morning, there's probably a million different places around the globe that are partaking of the Lord's Supper. Probably been partaken of over billions and billions of times from the time of Christ for over 2,000 years ago, would be repeated throughout the history of humanity. And it is to remind us of that sacred covenant that God made with his people thousands of years ago, 2,000 years ago. And so as we come to our dinner scenes and our dinner with Jesus story and our dinner with Jesus theme that we've been working on for the last 2 months, I can't think of any dinner scene that's greater than this. I can't think of, in the Bible, any dinner scene that's greater than this. I can't think in the history of the world a dinner scene that has more significance than this dinner scene. Right? Anybody think of a dinner scene that's more important than the Lord's Supper? I mean, you go to Europe and see all the paintings of the Lord's Supper, and you see how important it is in the history of humanity. And so this morning, we want to emphasize that. This is the biggest dinner, the most important ever dinner ever. Now, my daughter says that a lot. We throw that ever out there, you know. You go to the park, best thing ever, right? And we kind of use that as hyperbole or over-exaggeration, but I do not over-exaggerate in any way when I say biggest dinner scene ever, most important dinner scene ever. And that's what we are commemorating here this morning. And I want to take you to that scene this morning. I want you to notice in your outline, it's not your normal outline. If you're a visitor here, we normally have a much more detailed outline, and some of you OCD people are probably thinking, what am I going to write? What am I going to write? I don't know what to do here. I don't have anything to fill in. Normally I say, I want you to follow along and fill something in, and if you want to take notes, that's great, but we've had an ordered structure like we normally have it. And our message is going to be a little bit longer because we are shorter because we want to emphasize. Some of you just got real nervous when I said that, huh? I made that mistake. I saw eyes get really big. Longer? What are you talking about, Pastor? It's going to be a little bit shorter because we want to spend some time with the Lord's Supper itself. Also, our practice here at this church is when we take communion, we never do it as an add-on. We always teach about it before we partake of it. And so that's what we're doing this morning. I'm going to be teaching on the subject, and then we're going to take it together so that everybody here knows the significance of the Lord's Supper, that we take it in the right heart, in the right manner. Look into Luke chapter 22. Drop your eyes down to verse 7. We're going to go through 7 through verse 20. I want you to notice what it says here. It says in verse 7, it says, Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, go prepare a lamb for us that we may eat it. They said to him, where will you have us prepare it? And he said to them, behold, when you've entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house when he enters and tell the master of that house, the teacher says to you, where is the guest room that I may eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished. Prepare it there. And they went and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when the hour came, he reclined at the table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you that I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you, from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he had broken it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the same. That we get this practice that has been multiplied over millions and millions and millions of times through the history of humanity. And I want you to notice there's a connection that Luke makes in this text. He mentions it 5 times. There's a word that's really important to understanding the nature of this text. And that word is Passover. He mentions it in verse 7 and 8, 11, 13, and verse 15. And what Luke is really trying to do is trying to connect the act of the Passover to the significance of what Jesus is about ready to do. He's trying to make the overall imagery and connect them together to establish the fact that Jesus is going to be our Passover lamb. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the Passover if you're not familiar with what Passover means. During that time where Jesus is partaking of this Passover meal together, Josephus, who was an ancient historian, said that the city of Jerusalem would swell up to about 3 million people. Now, that's probably an over-exaggeration a little bit, but it probably got to the size of Fresno. And for ancient times, a city the size of Fresno was enormous. Why did it get so big during the time of the Passover? Well, it was because that people from all around the area would descend upon Jerusalem to take the Passover together and to partake in this festive event. It would be like Christmas around here. The merchants would come out and they would be selling their goods. The hotels would all say something to the effect of no vacancy on their doors. And the place would just be packed. You know, think of Black Friday. You know, everybody goes and gets the deals. People were thinking the same way in light of the Passover. They would load their camel up and wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning and go down to the local Walmart and get all kinds of stuff and load up and then take it home after Passover. It was a very festive event. But the center of all of those festivities revolved around the Passover meal that took place. Where families would gather together, similar to Thanksgiving, and they would have these meals, or friends would come together, and this Passover meal was to remind the people of how God delivered them from the Egyptians, and it would remind the people about how God rescued them from the hands of the Egyptians thousands of years beforehand. And so at this Passover meal, there were all different types of foods that were present to remind them of this event. It's called Seder, the Seder ceremony. And I want to share some of those foods with you to help you understand the significance of what's going on, because I want to connect Jesus to all of these in a minute. The first thing that they would have on this Passover meal were bitter herbs called marah. And what that was a combination of romaine lettuce and horseradish sauce. Horseradish. And they would mix that, and they would put the horseradish on the end of the lettuce, and they would eat that. Now, imagine that. It was not probably very tasty. You can almost just, right? In California, we might use cilantro or something like that instead of romaine, but it was a bitter vegetable with bitter herbs. And they would consume that. And the one who was giving that, the host of the Passover or the Seder meal, would have to explain the significance of each one of those elements. And so when this bitter herbs came along and people would bite it, he would say something like this, or she would say something like this. This is to remind you of the bitterness of slavery. This is to remind you of the harshness of the suffering that we had when we were in Egypt, but God delivered us from that. Making the connection, right? As you're biting that, that would have some significance to you, right? Man, this is bitter. And so the person would highlight that bitterness. But then after the bitter herbs, there was the second part of the meal, the second course of the meal, which was the charoset. And this looks like Nutella or something, right? And not Nutella. What it was is a mixture of fruit that they would come together. It was a sweet mixture, but it looks kind of like tar, or it looks kind of like perhaps masonry building, adobe, right? Does that make any connection for the people of Israel? Yeah, it was to remind them that they had to build these pyramids, and much of their time was enslaved doing what? Building pyramids and making mud to build pyramids. And so as you saw that imagery, you would be reminded of the suffering again of the Israelites while they were in Egypt together. But following that meal, or that part of the meal, then came the karpas. Some of you Hispanics are thinking, tripas? Well, that sounds good. No, karpas. Karpas, all that is cilantro, or not cilantro, celery, that they would dip into water, specifically salt water. Why do you think they would dip it into salt water? To remind them of the tears that they suffered, the tears that they shed while they were in Egypt. It's a really happy meal, right? I mean, we're really remembering the bitterness, we're remembering our slavery and making mud, we're remembering our tears, and then probably the most common, the one that people most know about would come next, would be the unleavened bread. In this unleavened bread, the Bible says that the people were to remember the Passover, they weren't supposed to have any yeast in their homes for 7 days leading up to the Passover. And the reason is this. The Bible tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 3, it says, "Do not eat bread made with yeast. For 7 days, eat unleavened bread, the bread of affliction." Do you realize that's what they called it? The bread that they were eating was what? The bread of affliction. There's another real lift-me-upper, right? We've got bitter tears, we've got mud, we've got more bitterness and affliction now. We've got all this stuff to remind the people of Israel of the great affliction that they were facing when they were slaves in Egypt. And so, really what it was, it says here, "The bread of affliction, because you left Egypt in haste, so that all of the days of your life, you remember the time of your departure of Egypt." And so what you were doing when you were taking the bread was to remember how quickly they had to go. That they didn't have time for the bread to rise when the Lord was going to come through and strike the Egyptians. And that they were under a great deal of affliction. And then the last part, sort of the part that everybody was aware of, the most known part of the meal was the main course, or the lamb, the roasted lamb, to be remembering the lamb that was sacrificed, or the lamb that was killed, in which the people had to place the blood of that lamb on the doorpost and the lintel of the doors to allow the angel of the Lord to pass by, or the Lord himself to pass by, and not to kill the people. Really, the Bible gives us the story. If you turn to Exodus, you have a Bible, real quick, I want you to turn to Exodus chapter 12. I want you to look at verse 7 through 14 with me. It tells us a little bit about why they had to put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost. The Lord said to them, "Then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the house in which they eat it. They will eat the flesh that night, roasted on the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. They will eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or broiled in water, but roasted, its head with its legs and its inner parts. And you shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until morning, you are going to burn. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belts fastened, your sandals on your feet, your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste," to remind them of the haste that they had to leave in, how quickly they had to leave the Egypt. "It is the Lord's Passover." Now listen, this is the significance. Why did they have to do it? Verse 12. "For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and I will see the blood, and I will," what's that word? "Pass over." That's where we get the word. "I will pass over, and no plague will befall you or destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day will be for you a memorial day, and you will keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout the generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast." What does it say? God says, now I'm going to be passing through, and only those people who have the blood applied on the doorpost and the lintel I will spare. Why? Because that is the indicator to me that you are not following the gods of the Egyptians, but that you believe in me, that you are following me, Yahweh, the God of Israel. And I want you to just imagine with me for a moment. They would take the blood, put it on the top, and then the tradition said they would go to the top, they would go to the right, and then they would apply it to the left. Okay? I want you to do that real quickly with me. Let's apply it together. Top, right, left. Top, right, left. One more time. This is kind of fun to watch you guys, actually. Top, right, left. Now, what does that remind you of? Top, right, left. Even thousands of years before Jesus was coming, the symbol of the cross would be present through the Passover, indicating what would go right here. The crown of thorns and the pierced hands of Jesus Christ, where the blood would be poured out for you and for me. That Jesus, in fact, was going to be our Passover lamb. This is why Jesus gives us this meal at this time. And this is why he says, "This is my body and this is my blood. And I'm making a covenant with you that if you apply my blood to the door frames of your life, I will rescue you. If you apply my blood and you take my blood as your sacrificial lamb and apply that to you, the bitterness of life is gone. You will have life. You will be set free. You will have joy in the future. I will deliver you from the slavery and the shackles that hold you back." What's the connection here in the Passover? Even that's why 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7 says that Christ is our Passover lamb and has been sacrificed for you and for me. That's the significance of the Passover at this time. In fact, the Bible gives us several indicators of how Christ is our Passover lamb. The first way that Christ is our Passover lamb, you realize that the lamb that was to be slaughtered was to be a male lamb in its prime. In the prime of life. You ever wonder why Christ came to the earth and he didn't stay here on the planet for 80-something years? We're talking about the Son of God, some wise teaching, the truth of God. Don't you think God would have thought, "Hey, you know what? It would be good to have this guy on the planet a lot longer than just a few years. But the sacrificial lamb was cut down in the prime of life because he is our Passover lamb. Second element that the Bible tells us about Jesus and the Passover lamb back in the days of the Passover was that there was to be no blemish on the lamb. Right? Chapter 12, verse 5 of Exodus tells us that the lamb was to be spotless. Do you realize that the Bible says of Jesus Christ in 1 Peter 1:19 that he is our, the exact words here is that he is a lamb without blemish or defect. Why did he have to be without blemish or defect? Because he is our Passover lamb, the one who will rescue us from the wrath of God, which brings us to the next element. The Bible tells us in the Old Testament that whoever rejected the Passover blood, that if you never applied the Passover blood to the door frames of your house, what would happen? You would face the wrath and the judgment of God, right? It was the demonstration that you were not a follower of Yahweh, that you were not a person who believed in Yahweh. You know what the Bible says about applying the blood of Christ into our life? Christ tells us himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man gets to the Father except through me. Romans tells us this. He says, much more than being now justified by his blood, we are saved from God's wrath through him. Think about that. Does that not have some connections back to the Passover? You are saved from God's wrath through him. Now, I know some of you here this morning are like, oh, wrath. Oh, that's a downer. Don't talk about God's wrath. Here's the thing. I mean, I don't get delight in talking about God's wrath. And I know that that's probably a taboo to talk about on a Sunday morning at our church. But the Bible actually speaks of God's wrath, of those who will not apply the blood of Jesus Christ to the frames of their life. Those aren't my words, by the way. That's what I'm following from Scripture. And I really believe this book that we're studying in. So this morning, if you haven't applied the blood of Jesus Christ, your Passover lamb, to your life, if you're not living your life on the door frames, what is that symbolic of? That which holds up the house. If Jesus Christ and his blood does not hold up the house of your life, the Bible has some pretty significant things to say regarding you and some pretty rough things to say. And so my desire for you is that you would take the blood of Christ and symbolically apply that to your life and say, I believe that Christ is my Passover lamb, and I apply his blood. It's through his blood that I am saved, that I am rescued. But the Bible also says that none of the lamb's bones were to be broken in the Passover. You realize the Bible goes out of its way to talk about that Jesus' bones weren't broken? You know, often on the cross, when people were crucified on the cross, they would be held up by their legs that would allow them to keep breathing. And so in an act of mercy or an act of actually just killing the people more rapidly, soldiers would take a big sledgehammer to their legs. And that would break their legs so that they would die much more quickly. But the Bible, and John goes through meticulous detail to explain to us that Jesus' legs weren't broken. Why does he want to explain that to us? He wants to explain that to us to help us to understand that Jesus was in fact our Passover lamb. Then one more element that I want to discuss about him being our Passover lamb. You realize that the Bible says that the Passover lamb was supposed to be chosen 5 days before the Passover. Meaning this, on the 10th day of Nisan, the lamb would be chosen and it would be visible for everyone to see. Why? To make sure that everybody saw that that lamb was out without blemish. And so, what's interesting, when we look at when Jesus comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey, what day does he come in? Everybody knows this, right? Palm Sunday, 5 days before. And you know what the Bible says that he does in those 5 days? He goes to the temple every day so that the people would see that he was, in fact, the lamb without blemish. The last element that the Bible says about this whole event of Passover, why were the Jews supposed to celebrate it? They were to do it as a remembrance of God's rescue. All throughout the Old Testament, it says that the people were to observe the Passover to remember and to be able to tell to their descendants of what God did in rescuing the people. You know what Jesus says in this meal? What does he say? He says, do this in what? Remembrance of me. So what we do And we teach our children through this event. We come to this event and we remember this meal that Jesus had, that he is our Passover lamb, that his blood was poured out for me. And I just looked at that lamb as I was looking at that visually this week on the internet and seeing the lamb laying there. I'm thinking of Jesus as my lamb who suffered and died and bled so that I might be able to live, so that I might be able to have abundant life, that I might have eternal life. So I want you this morning, as we get ready to take the Passover lamb and participate in this and remember Jesus, that's exactly what I want you to do. I want you to understand that what we're doing is not just sort of a religious act that's an add-on at the end of the service. It's not just something to, Jesus is just saying, hey, what a great moral teacher I am, what a cool guy I was, or, you know, just something that's sort of nonchalant like that. What he is saying and what we need to remember as we partake of this elements this morning is this is part of his new covenant with us, that he is the Passover lamb, and if you believe in him, and if you celebrate him, and you apply his blood and have applied it to the door frames of your life, you are free to partake of the Lord's Supper this morning. And he has set you free. You're no longer slave to bitterness. You're no longer slave to affliction. You're set free. How many of us believe that this morning? I hope that most of us do. I hope that we remember that as we participate in this morning. If you believe that this morning, that he is your Passover lamb, we encourage you to participate in the Lord's Supper this morning. But I just want to offer one word of caution, and we always do this as we partake of the Lord's Supper. If you don't believe that Jesus died for you, for your sin, if you don't believe that he has applied his blood as that which will save us, then you probably don't want to partake of it this morning. I know you can go to lots of places and they just want everybody to partake, but the Bible talks about some guidelines for this. It doesn't just say, hey, it's time to get a snack and some grape juice. And so I want us to be educated in that. Not that I don't want anybody not to partake, but I want you to understand what the Bible says about this and how important it is that we understand what we are doing. My daughter came with me in the service this morning, and they didn't have children's church, and so I made sure that when it came time to participate in this, I called her forward. I made her stop, right, sit right there. I said, babe, we're going to go through this. So I'm ministering this, and I would go and sit with her and talk with her and tell her, this is what this means. And make sure that she knew what this means. Because it's significant. And the Bible talks about the fact that we can make a mockery of this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says that many people have taken it in an unworthy manner. And I don't want anybody to take it in an unworthy manner this morning. I would rather us all understand what we're doing and the significance of it. By the way, our church is not closed communion. If you come into this church, you don't have to be part of our church. You don't have to be a member of our church. You don't have to have the secret Eucharist handshake that we teach you in a private class. We don't have any of that kind of stuff. We invite all to partake of the Lord's Supper if you have applied the blood of Jesus Christ to your life. That's what's the most important thing. But if you haven't done that, the Bible says maybe you ought to think about not doing this. And this, by the way, doesn't mean that you have to be perfect. If we all had to be perfect, well, who would be able to take it here? None of us at all in this place. But however, we do need to understand what we're doing and why we're doing it, mainly that we are remembering and we are celebrating that Christ is our Passover lamb. That's why this Dinner with Jesus series, or this Dinner with Jesus, unfolds with his disciples. He wants to remind them that he is their Passover lamb. Do you believe that this morning? But then the second, there's one more qualification that I need to discuss that goes also to the book of 1 Corinthians, where Paul is talking about people who have taken the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. The second criteria for it is if you have any animosity towards your brother or sister in the body of Christ, the Bible says you probably shouldn't take it. because Paul says that there was bickering and there was lack of unity and there was fighting that was going on in the church of Corinth. And he says, how is it that you guys are getting together and having the Lord's Supper and you're fighting with one another? You don't really know what the Lord's Supper entails, do you? Because we are part of the one body of Christ. I always like to say, when we have our bread here, it all comes from the same loaf, right? It doesn't come, I don't get Wonder Bread and then banana bread and then raisin bread and then all this other and say, hey, we're all part of a different loaf. No, we are all part of the same loaf, right? Look around. You are part of the same loaf in the body of Christ. And so if you are not united in the body of Christ, the Bible says you need to deal with that before you partake in the Lord's Supper this morning. We want to take a couple of minutes before we partake, and we're going to ask Brian to come and play some music, and I want to invite you to do two things before we actually get to the Lord's Supper. First of all, if you're here and you've never applied the blood of Jesus to your life, if you've never received Him, if you've never said, Lord, I believe that You died as my Passover lamb for my sins, I'd love for you to be able to do that this morning. Get that taken care of. That's the most important thing. It is that which causes the wrath of God to pass over you. It's important. It's a big deal. Okay? So this morning, if you've never done that, maybe right where you're at this morning, you can invite the Lord into your life. We have a prayer that we'd like to give people here at our church. I would invite us now just to, let's all just close our eyes unless you want to say this prayer. If you've never invited the Lord into your life, never applied the blood of Christ to the door frame of your life, look at this prayer here this morning. Pray something like this. Lord, I need You. I admit I'm a sinner and I need Your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus died in my place, paying the penalty for my sins. I'm willing right now to turn from my sins. Accept Jesus Christ to be my Master, King, and Lord of my life. I fully surrender myself to You. Take control of me and help me become the person You want me to be. Thank You for loving me. I'd like to add, thank You for being my Passover lamb. If that's the desire of your heart this morning, you've invited Christ into your life, I'd invite you just in a moment before we take our Passover. We're going to have an invitation where I'm going to invite different people to come to the altar and just talk to the Lord about the different things in their life before we get together and start partaking of the Lord's Supper. But if you've invited Christ into your life for the first time, maybe you haven't been walking with the Lord and you need to get some things right with Him. Before you take the Lord's Supper this morning, would you come and have somebody pray with you this morning? There'll be people here in front of the church that would pray with you about what you need to do to get things right with the Lord. I'd invite you to come. We have different people at different times come for all different reasons to get things right with the Lord. I want everybody to have the right heart, everybody here this morning to partake of the Lord's Supper and remember the application of the blood of Christ into our lives this morning. I would invite you to come. Maybe you're here this morning and you've got some bitterness, you've got some animosity, you've got some problems towards somebody else in the body of Christ that you need to address this morning. Maybe you want to come and take care of those things this morning as well. Maybe you've got other things going on in your life. This is the time that we prepare our hearts, whether you come forward or whether you're in your seat this morning. Prepare your hearts. Remember what Christ has done for us. When we remember what He's done for us, that's a big deal. It's the most amazing thing when we stop and think about it. Sometimes in the ebb and flow of life, I get caught up in just living life, and I forget the significance of the Passover lamb who allows me to escape the wrath of God. And instead, I'm called a child of God. I'm adopted by God. I'm granted eternal life. Morning. If you need to pray with somebody, I invite you to come. If you need to take care of some things in your life, before we partake of the Lord's Supper, let me tell you, it'll be good. It'll be good to cleanse that and just get yourself squared away with where God wants you to be. Let's all stand together. Let's sing together. We're going to sing a song as we invite people to come. I'm going to invite our ushers to come, who are going to be our deacons, and Phil to come, Phil Wood to come. Stand up here as we get ready to partake of the Lord's Supper.
Jesus Christ, think upon your sacrifice. Praise, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord, we have to remember you. And Lord, it's the gift that you have blessed us with that we are unworthy of, Lord. We are standing in awe of your grace. So, Lord, as we take this in remembrance of you, Lord, allow us to not forget the price that was paid for us. We pray this in Jesus' holy name.
We take this in remembrance of you, our Passover lamb. It says in verse 20 of Luke 22, it says, "And likewise he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, This cup is poured out for you as the new covenant in my blood."
Thank you.
Sacrifice that saved my life. Lord, we take the blood of the Passover lamb in remembrance of you. Lord, we thank you for our time together. We thank you that we can remember what you've done, Lord, for us. I pray that as we walk out of here, this place, in the hustle and bustle of life, Lord, we could have a greater appreciation for that dinner that you had with your disciples 2,000 years ago, Lord, and that dinner would just make a big difference in our lives. I pray everybody here would daily apply the blood of the Lamb on the door frames of their life, God. Help us to come out of here with a deeper awareness of the sacrifice that was made and saved our lives, God. Lord, we come to you this morning, giving you thanks for that lamb that was sacrificed on our behalf. In your name, amen. We're going to sing another song. Hang on to your cups. On your way out, the ushers will collect those for you this morning. Just hang on to them for a minute. We're going to sing one song together as a congregation. We're going to welcome a new family into our church, and then we're going to be dismissed.
Greatest love that anyone could ever know. Lord, you came to the cross and prayed to find my soul. Till I see you face to face, face to face, it takes me home. Trust in you. All I have to live to see your kingdom come.
us this morning.